Hello and welcome to this Red Gaming Tech video. Myself and Marta, where as always I'm here with the latest from the tech world in the last 24 or so hours. As you can hear, I am slightly less nasal than previously. I am slowly on the mend, getting there, feeling a little less like death warmed over each day, which is always nice. So, let's kick things off, shall we, with something interesting from Intel. So you undoubtedly remember the former CEO, Brian Krzanich of Intel, of course, who stepped down due to a relationship with an employee that violated company policy. Go watch our video on that if somehow you missed the news, which I highly doubt. It was quite the scandal at the time, but it will be linked in the description if you're so curious. Anyway, and after a 7-month search, Intel has named Robert Swan the new CEO of Intel, and he has actually been with the company since 2016 and has actually been serving as the interim chief executive since Brian stepped down in June of last year. And this is despite the fact that, again, he has kind of been keeping the seat warm in the meantime while Intel were on the search for the new CEO. Robert Swan was adamant that he didn't want to be permanently in this position, but either he was keeping it strum because he didn't quite know what was happening yet, or they managed to convince him otherwise or something else entirely. So obviously he's got a bit of a hard task ahead of him because obviously Intel, well, they are still Intel, they have had some troubles as of late with, of course, the almost meme level of 10nm delays and, of course, the issues with the 14nm supply, as well as AMD very much being hot on their heels and taking advantage of these windows that Intel has been giving them. So he's got a bit of a tough job ahead of him, basically. He's not exactly got a smooth transition into heading up this particular company. But I have a bit of a statement here from the chairman, Andy Bryant, who said, quote, as Intel continues to transform its business to capture more of a large and expanding opportunity that includes the data center, artificial intelligence, and autonomous driving, while continuing to get value from the PC business, the board concluded after a thorough search that Bob is the right leader to drive Intel into its next era of growth. We considered many outstanding executives and we concluded the best choice is Bob. Important in the board's decision was the outstanding job Bob did as interim CEO for the past 7 months, as reflected in Intel's outstanding results in 2018. Now we do have a bit of a statement here from Robert himself as to the future of Intel, but unsurprisingly doesn't really lay out a fully detailed roadmap, just kind of gives an indication that we're going to be seeing some changes on the horizon. He said, quote, our core strategy is not changing. We embarked on what we believe can be the most successful transformation in corporate history. We're evolving from a PC-centric to a data-centric company that builds a technology foundation powering the world's innovation. So, long story short, after 7 months, Robert Swan has been given the job of Intel CEO. So let's wish him all the best of luck. Obviously, I'm sure he's rather happy, but I'm sure he's very aware of the task ahead of him, as he's in a bit of troubled waters at the helm of this particular ship. So, let's move on, shall we, to NVIDIA. Or more specifically, this is regarding the mobile lineup of the RTX series. So, what do we actually have here going on? Well, the situation seems fairly standard at first glance, but bear with me while I just go through this because I do kind of need to set the stage a little bit before I actually get to the point. So, if the reports are accurate, and this is all coming from a report from TechSpot, and of course that will be linked in the description below this video, and if we are going to be seeing what they are reporting, it's going to be a little difficult for you, the customer, to actually get the performance that they desire from product to product. They might have to do a bit of guesswork, a bit of digging, all that sort of stuff. Because basically what we have here is some pretty wild variation between different versions of the mobile parts. So for example, for the 2080 Max-Q, that can be clocked at 735 MHz, which is a 50% downclock from the desktop version, which of course is at 1515 MHz. And the non-Max-Q, of the RTX 2080 is clocked around 1380 MHz, which is still 200 MHz down. But before you say it, it's obviously perfectly normal to see lower clocks for these products, especially when you're talking about the RTX 2080. Especially for the Max-Q variant, because Max-Q is ultra thin. So obviously it can't really deal with the thermal issues and power requirements of a standard mobile GPU. So obviously you're going to be seeing some lower clock speeds there. So you might scratch your head and go, okay, so what is actually the issue? Well, the problem is that when you get manufacturers who are not disclosing the clock speeds of the GPU, so for example, you might buy an MSI laptop or an Asus or whoever, the manufacturer is not really relevant here, that apparently have the exact same setup, but you'd have two GPUs that are operating at very different clock speeds and very different levels of performance. Now, obviously, I would always say do your research when it comes to buying anything as expensive as a laptop or even any PC part. You know, make sure you're getting the right part for your build, not only in terms of actually, you know, will it work? Is it compatible with your motherboard? Is it actually going to be powered correctly? Have you got enough power going into it? All that sort of stuff. You know, you should always do that research. But obviously, we're talking about pre-built laptops here. And again, while I'll still say, yes, you should do your research, a lot of people are not really going to know what they're looking at, perhaps, and if it's not made really clear that, hey, this is like a lower power version, they might buy it thinking, oh yeah, I'm getting this really awesome RTX 2080, and yes, they are, but they're getting one that's a 50% disadvantage versus another one that's got, you know, only a 200 megahertz downclock versus the desktop counterparts. And if you look at the Nvidia website, you will see there's quite a variation in all of the specs, really, when it comes to power, the amount of CUDA cores, all that sort of stuff. So yeah, they just need to make it super crystal clear. And if you are looking into buying a mobile RTX laptop, just be very careful in what you are purchasing. But let's move on, shall we, to AMD. So you may have seen the news of AMD's recent earnings call and rather bold, shall we say, 2019 predictions. And as a result, we have seen some very impressive results for AMD stock. And it's not exactly surprising, given that they announced that their 2018 full-year revenue had grown 23% year-on-year and represented a second year of double-digit growth. They saw their share price go up by 20% in a single day. So, yeah, AMD were definitely flying high. However, their predictions for this year were not free from criticism. Some industry analysts said that the 2019 outlook was a little overambitious, or according to Jim Cramer, a little too, quote, aggressive. But obviously, Dr. Lisa Su, who is of course the CEO of AMD, has been keen to counter that opinion in a recent interview about their earnings and of course the 2019 guidance figures. So here's what she had to say. Quote, certainly there are some concerns about what's going on in China. Let's not major on those things. Let's major on the product story. We think our products, especially our 7nm products in the data center and on PCs, are going to be extremely competitive. We'll be first to 7nm in 2019, and that's a big competitive advantage. She is, of course, talking about here Radeon 7, because that's going to be launching next week. It is going to be the first consumer 7nm product. And of course, we're all eagerly awaiting to see what exactly is happening with the third gen Ryzen processor range, Ryzen 3000 or Zen 2 to be more specific. And of course, Epic as well is on 7nm, and it, as I keep stressing over and over and over, it is the data center where AMD have really been sticking the irons to Intel the most. But essentially, what Lisa's saying here is that she's confident that the same thing that's carried them through 2018 is going to continue to do so with their new desktop and server processors. And she said, quote, we added $1.2 billion of new revenue, and it's really on the basis of products and product momentum. That's been our story over the last few years, and it's about gaining market share, and particularly we're very pleased with our PC market and data center results. Now, of course, she's going to say this. She's not exactly going to throw up her hands and be like, oh, do you know what, guys? You're right, about to be a little bit too ambitious. Now, obviously, that's not going to happen. But you can't exactly blame her for feeling confident, given that the year AMD have had. Now, obviously, Intel's issues with 10nm and 14nm have definitely given them windows, but obviously, they have still had to properly take advantage of those opportunities, and I would argue they very much have done. And of course, we're all waiting to see exactly what Radeon 7 is capable of. We did see some leaks the other day from 3D Mark and Final Fantasy 15. Go check out their video if you haven't seen it already. It gives a little peek under the hood, a little look at the performance that we might be able to expect. But again, I would really wait for more benchmarks before we start writing the GPU off one way or the other. Writing it on, I suppose you should say. But AMD definitely seemed poised to just continue the streak that they've been on. But whether or not they'll be able to, we'll have to see. Radeon 7 is, of course, come under criticism by some. And, of course, there's been a lot of debate about what's going on with Ryzen 3000. And, of course, Intel are insisting, very much insisting, that 10nm is out this year. So Intel are obviously very keen to kind of be back again, sort of taking some of this market back from AMD, but obviously AMD are not going to take that lying down. So yeah, to be honest, such a competitive AMD is good for us as a consumer, because we have seen it really wake Intel up and be like, oh, okay, we've actually got someone who's challenging us now. We need to actually be competitive and innovate, because again, competition breeds innovation. If you are the top dog with no one even slightly challenging you, what reason do you have to do anything other than what you have to? There's no reason for you to do anything crazy, because why would you? So yeah, let's hope this does continue, because a more competitive AMD is better for us as consumers. And of course, I'm not talking just against Intel either, I'm talking also against Nvidia. So let's move on, shall we, to something a little bit surprising regarding Microsoft Windows. Now, speaking of chip shortage, we have a very odd, I would say, or at least surprising, victim of that chip shortage: Microsoft's Windows business. They also had their earnings call, and they said that Windows OEM results were lower than expected because of chip availability issues. And I have a bit of a statement here from Amy Hood, Microsoft's chief financial officer, and she said, quote, "In Windows, the overall PC market was smaller than we expected, primarily due to the timing of chip supply to our OEM partners, which constrained an otherwise healthy PC ecosystem and negatively affected both OEM Pro and non-Pro revenue growth. Windows OEM Pro revenue declined 2%, roughly in line with the commercial PC market. OEM non-Pro revenue declined 11%, below the market, which continued pressure in the entry-level category." So what does this actually mean in practical terms, I hear you ask? Well, apparently this meant that consumer sales of Microsoft Office also took a hit, but we did still see $13 billion in revenue in their more personal computing business, which is a 7% increase over last quarter, and this is primarily helped along by the success of the Surface, such as the Surface Pro 6. And again, despite these issues, we saw strong results elsewhere in Azure and LinkedIn. But yeah, they did basically not as well as they thought with OEMs just due to these chip shortages. So let's finish up, shall we, with something regarding the Nintendo Switch. Now, obviously, this console has been doing very, very well for itself, and there's been a lot of speculation about what Nintendo are going to be doing next. Are we going to be seeing a sort of pro version of the console, smaller version, that sort of thing? And in a recent post by the Japanese publication Nikkei, which was helpfully translated by Nintendo Everything, it seems they are definitely thinking of selling a smaller version of the Switch. And the post from Nintendo Everything reads, quotes, "They're taking measures as for what is to come, one of those being a smaller version of the Switch. The company said it couldn't comment on their plans for the products, but has informed multiple suppliers and game development companies that they intend to release them as early as 2019. According to their affiliates, they are miniaturizing the console portability and playing outdoors in mind, as well as cutting features to reduce the price and expand the user base." So are we going to be seeing a fully handheld Switch, possibly? That sounds like it, because if they're focusing on portability, then yeah, or it could just be a smaller Switch with a smaller dock is entirely possible. We'll have to wait and see, but it's clear that Nintendo are doing something. They want to do some new version of the Switch, if it couldn't be called the Slim or the Mini or whatever, it's irrelevant. The difference is going to be the same. Very curious to see what exactly they end up doing, but unfortunately no hints were given at all. So that is me done for this video. Thank you very much for watching and bearing with me with my slightly nasally voice. I am slowly getting there, so just bear with me a couple more days, guys. I think I'll be back to my normal sparkling self by then. Anyway, that is me done for this video. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.